Welcome to the afternoon session of the European Canoe Marathon Championships in Bohinje in Slovenia this day of 2015. We are in Bohinje, and the Bohinje is a very, very nice place for canoeing and in general. The conditions here is fantastic. The water is like a mirror, and it's quite warm, and it is very interesting racing going on. On the start line now, we have under 23 K1 men. And it is 22 competitors. Among them, it is four former world champs, junior world champs, which is quite impressive. We will go further into that during the race. They will paddle seven laps, and six portages. Portages is where the paddlers jump out their boats and run across 100 meters of land. About that, and they are ready to start now, and off they are.
So this is the first real sizable start field we've had today. A lot of people in here with a lot of experience, much more so than the juniors obviously, and you'd expect to see quite big groups form today. Hopefully we'll be able to talk you through what they're doing, what they're trying to think. But great to see Nick Romain from Great Britain up there. That's purely biased on my part on account of that's where I come from. But he has made a great start, cracking along there on a beautiful wash and looking very safe at the moment. Okay, unfortunately we're missing a few athletes off our start, but it looks like a Danish athlete leading at the moment, boat 253, and to his left Nick Romain from Great Britain, really pushing on, and he's actually dropped round the back of the yellow boat there. We'll try and get your names and numbers. So he's dropped round, he's looking safe on the left hand side. Phenomenal start for Nick there, who raced in Oklahoma last year and finished 20th out there. So any result top 10 here for him would be a big improvement and reward for the training he's been doing. Nick from Richmond Canoe Club, one of the biggest clubs in the UK, and with the camera angles we get, we're not going to see an awful lot of exactly what's happening, but you can see that it's pretty busy up there. Quite stressful times for the athletes here. For some of them, they have one chance and one chance only to get on a good wash and get with a good group. Others got a bit more speed, a bit more talent maybe, they can afford a mistake or two. But for those one chance people, that first leg up there, no mistakes, otherwise your race is going to end badly. Milling round in front of us in the commentary box now, we got the C1s, just 10 of them in this race. It's the under 23 C1s. We expect more of a procession from them, and the big names going to be Hungary, Spain, all the usual suspects, Poland again, who did so well in the junior race earlier today. The cameras focusing on the back of the under 23s, bit of trouble for the Belgian athlete there. With the camera angles as they are, it's virtually impossible to tell you who exactly is who.
We will soon have the angle from the camera out up there at the first turn, 1750 meters from the start line. Each lap it's about 4 kilometers, and they are doing 7 laps and 6 portages, which means that the first lap goes without portage. So within 15 minutes or so we will have them back here, or a little bit less. this big group. It's really a big group, Ivan.
It's great to see. I mean, you've got educated paddlers now. They've done the junior system. They've come into the under-23s. And actually, the speed of the under-23 race isn't any different to the speed of the senior race. And equally, having said that, the junior race is also no slower. If you look at the times from Oklahoma last year, the lap times are pretty similar. But it's also very difficult for these guys to make the progression through those classes. And the difference is the education. They haven't had time yet to learn about the other athletes, about how to perform in a race this size and with this many people. How many of these guys get to race in a field that big at home? Probably none.
Could be the Hungarians and Spaniards, but otherwise, absolutely so. And now it's time to start C1 men under 23. It's 10 boats there. Also, them an interesting field with some really experienced paddlers. Among them, Jan Dluhy from Czech Republic, that have been around quite a lot.
And of course, Levanti Bala from Hungary, who was junior world champion in Oklahoma. And it's the blue boat of Hungary in the middle, about four up from the bottom, which maybe, or three up.
The Hungarian with their green track suits.
So that is Bala.
That is Bala, yes, and it's followed by Spain. Spain, Quintans Gonzalez. And the Vega Carlos, and I think it's Carlos Vega that is up there in top for the moment. Carlos Vega and Bala. Hungary and Spain, exactly as it should be in C1 racing.
As it always pans out.
Yeah.
But we got another Polish athlete in this one today, and the Poles we saw did very well in the junior C1, so maybe they can add something to this.
Absolutely, and Czech Republic almost always have good C1 paddlers in these categories. And then we see the big group, and it's the big group of K1, and it's Hungary in top, and it might be Laszlo Solti, who was third in this category in Oklahoma last year, and is also a junior world champ from the year before. Laszlo Solti from Hungary. And then it's Spain on the inner side. Spain with always paddling in the Helio boats. You can easily recognize them by that. And I think it is Alejandro Sanchez, who were second at the Europeans last year and won in Vila Verde in Portugal at the Europeans 2013.
You can see it's still a big big group there, but it's quite well strung out. It's not too wide, the group. It's quite long. Then you're starting to stress at the back, because if a gap opens up and you're behind that gap, there's not much you can do. You have to wait for someone else to bridge that gap. It's not something you can do on your own from the back. So there's quite a lot of stress out there at these sort of situations. There's somebody at the front who's comfortable. There's somebody tucked in the V at the front who's even more comfortable. But to either side of the leaders, there are people who are working harder than they should. And at the back of that group, there's a lot of pressure on those guys to make their way forward.
Absolutely, and it's a lot of rough water as well back there. So it's in such big groups, it's not always so that the hardest paddling is in the front. It could be quite comfortable there compared to a little bit backwards in the big group, where the water is rough and it's always fighting for positions.
What you're looking for in those back positions is that when there are changes, you always want to move forward one position rather than drop back one position. So gradually you can make your way up and hopefully get in contact. Now, it's quite difficult making your way up, especially once you get close to the front end, because then you have to challenge the good guys for the washes that they want. So at some stage, you have to know where you fit. You can't go pushing the good guys around because it's too expensive for you. You have to judge well who you're racing and pick the places that are left to you. There's a hierarchy out there, and if you're not welcome and the good guys don't make you welcome, then it's a hard life.
It is, and it works like that in the top group, that everyone is looking for a position to hang on a good wash, and the best wash is right behind the leading guy and on both sides of him. And that is the positions everyone is fighting for. And to challenge one of these guys, it takes some efforts, and they will fight you off as best as they can. So it's stressful and it's a lot of work there. It could be a good tactic if you are endurant and the speed in the top group isn't that high, to just use the calm water at the side for the first kilometers to avoid tiring out. But then you definitely must be in the group. So
you got to get to the group in the end, and you have to be very confident to break away from the group. And these guys probably haven't got enough experience to know whether they can do that or not. The group has a feeling of safety, even if it's not... not an actual true feeling of safety. And you, provided you're in there, you've still got a chance.
I think that's part of humanity. Group
group mentality.
Yeah.
So C1's coming up to the first turn then. As expected, two Hungarians left and right of those, two Spanish. And
Stefan, could you ask Matt to come to me at the TV van, please, if he's around? Thank you.
They're making their way to that first turn. Again, head-on shot. It's really difficult to see who's leading. It looks to me like the Hungarian in the reddish boat.
Ryan is asking for you.
But everything looks well under control there. And finally, we've got some C1s doing some wash hanging. The skill level goes up, obviously, with practice. These guys have raced before. That helps. And we've got a bit of a group building here. Two Hungarians, two Spanish seem to have broken away from the rest of the field.
And it's Bala Lavente Bala, the world champ from last year, together with Bala Snagi from Hungary in the lead there. And then Carlos Vega from Spain and Damian Gonzalez, also Spain. Both the Spanish guys are there.
You can see sometimes in shot here how difficult it is for them to steer on the wash. They end up adjusting their body position and putting their paddle out wide or bringing it in close just to stay safe, really, to not crash into the other boats. You can see how difficult it is. With the kayaks, it's so simple. You just move your steering bar across and it's job done. But these guys, it is more difficult. You can see that just from an overview. Hopefully, for entertainment's sake, that group will stay together and we'll be able to have a bit of a discussion on who we think's looking good later on. Spaniard in the white boat looks to be struggling as they come around the turn. We could be down to three. Go past the timing system. The pole you see on the raft there is what reads the chip in the numbers and gives you the on-screen feedback as to positions and times. We should get some of those up through this race at some stage. Quick change of lead there, and the group will settle again. So back to the K1s as they approach the turn two, three, actually. It's a triangular course. Still a big group, just a couple dangling off the back there. Hard to see who they are.
It's Portugal, I think. Portugal in the lead.
It'll be Miguel Rodriguez.
He was fourth in Oklahoma and in the World Championships last year, so he's definitely one of the top athletes in this group. And he was third in Villa Verde. Now he's 1 year older and he's heading the big pack into this turning point. And this lap, it won't be a portage, so they will just paddle around this turn. And as you can see, he's leaving good room for everyone, experience enough to understand that the crashes and try to squeeze people at the boys is no idea.
So it's even hard to count the number of athletes in that group. You've got to be about 12 athletes in there.
Yeah.
And in some ways, that's nice. The more athletes there are in a group, the more choices you have as to which wash you go on. There's always something left over for you. But it can get a bit busy, especially around the turns. So Portugal leading. Portugal got a great reputation at the European Championships. José Ramalho, obviously. Lionel Ramalho, been European champion in the seniors.
And then it's Italy. Italy is there with Filippo Vincenzi on the second position, 268 on his boat.
And 269 Sanchez Cobos from Spain.
267. It's Marcel Puffler who finished seventh in Oklahoma from Germany. He has been around quite a while and have always been among the top in the first stages of the race. We'll see this time if he has got experience enough to stand in the top group all the way through.
He's got a couple of stragglers falling off that group. Just out of shot, you can just see the bow of his boat. White cap, it's hard to tell who he was. He pretty much put his paddles down there. Clinging on the back of that group, another athlete from Great Britain, Sam Plummer from Leighton Buzzard Canoe Club, also doing well to be there. Actually, he did well to be on the start. He missed the start in Oklahoma last year. Seriously, who does that, Stefan? Who does that? So at least he made the start, and not only has he made the start, he's on the back of that front group. So both British athletes in there, and from my point of view, that can only be a good thing.
Absolutely.
So we might get a shot of who's just dangling off the group there. 263, is it? Slovakia and Filip Spruzanski. Maybe he's just decided to do exactly what Stefan said, find himself some clear water and do his own thing. He certainly doesn't look too stressed out there, does he?
No. It could be quite beneficial to do that when the lactic acid is hurting. Pick a good wash out there at the side and just go for the calm water for a couple of minutes. But you need really to keep up with the speed, otherwise it will be a struggle to close the gap once again. As said, we have many very experienced paddlers here. We have boat number 260, that is Karl-Anders Slettsjö, who was a world champion as a junior already in 2011 in K2 in Singapore. Karl-Anders Slettsjö, who I think is the third generation of paddlers participating, and his sister Anna participated also in the under 23 women earlier here today. And also their mother took a gold medal, Ingeborg Rasmussen, in the World Championships in Copenhagen 1990. Boat number 262 is Miguel Rodriguez, that we saw in top on the wash hanging on the Portuguese paddler that is in the lead. Miguel Rodriguez, who was fourth in Oklahoma and third in the European Championships 2013 in Villa Verde. We also have 266 from Hungary, Adam Petro, who was a junior world champ in Rome 2012. Very good Hungarian paddler, endurant, and as I remember, with a great in-sprint as well. And then boat 267 is Marcel Puffler from Germany. Finished seventh in Oklahoma, 1 year older now. And Marcel Puffler have been also in the junior category and here, so he has quite an experience. And then 161 is Laszlo Solti, junior world champ and third in K2 last year in third in K1 actually last year in Oklahoma, a bronze medalist there. Both 269 from Spain, Cobos Sanchez, Alejandro Sanchez, that we know quite well now. He was second at the Europeans and won in last year and won in Villaverde. It seems like Carl-Anders Slätsjö has given up this effort here today. We can see him paddling to the bank here. Sad for him. Something has happened to him. So Norway lost their hope in this category.
It's always difficult to come to an event like this, and maybe he hasn't been well for the week before, but he's decided to compete anyway. You don't really know the backstory of all these guys on the day.
Of course not.
I know one of the Danish athletes today who was also in with a big chance, Pedersen. He's retired out, pulled out of the race today through illness.
Yeah, and he was a world champ last year, junior world champ last year.
Right. So yeah, another big name who isn't actually on the water this morning, and that's just the luck of the draw, really. That's sport, good days and bad days, and that's you have to take both.
Sad for Norway then. They had the European champion last year, Morten Minde, who won the European Championships last year in Piestany in this category, with Alejandro Sanchez on second position. And Italy, no, Spain, were also on the bronze position with Guillermo Fidalgo back then. And he's too old for this category now.
Few changes of formation up the front there, bit of a burst of speed here and there, and that gives you the opportunity always for a reshuffle. If you're on a wash you don't like, those bursts of speed are quite welcome. Nick Romain doing a grand job still, he's still up there. In fact, he might be in the lead diamond now, and as the speed picks up and the race goes on, there is no better place to be.
It was quite a high speed for a while there, now they are down a little bit once again, but still quite rapid actually. I think it's Denmark now in the lead. We'll see
very
soon.
So we got Spanish on his left, to the right Hungary, obviously 268. No, that's not right, is it? Laszlo Solti.
Solti, Laszlo Solti, yes, 268.
But not in a green top?
No, but I think the leading guy was 253, actually.
Right, okay.
And that should be Nikolaj Mørke from Denmark. But I'm quite unsure on that, but it could be. He was in the top also in the start here.
So whoever the leader is, we got Spain to his right, Hungary to his left, Great Britain in the V at the back. Go, Nick Romain. And then Portugal just trying to come up the outside now. Now the danger of being in the V in this situation with good guys coming round is that they can squeeze you out of there. So you need to know that you've got enough speed to hold your own. Maybe make a couple of friends before it's too late as well.
Exactly.
Do a few people a few favours and those favours get returned many times over quite often. So it's knowing how to behave in the group as well as knowing your way around the group is equally important. See, one race is down to two now, which is a bit disappointing. You hope the Spanish would have given it a bit of a better run than that, but that's two Hungarians. Actually, I've got no proof the Spanish is now in front in this shot, actually, but I'm making an assumption. I've just had a little word in my ear from the people in the know, and the Spaniard is definitely not out in front. Thanks for that, Brian. You've earned your job there.
And us, who is running this broadcasting this afternoon, is me, Stefan Gustafsson, and Ivan Lawler. And Brian Chapman is picking the camera views like a producer for this.
We got one of the rescue boats coming back in front of us. They look like they've got another casualty on board. A blue boat just coming in on the... being brought in. With an unhappy athlete on board, I'm guessing.
And that is Velibor Marinkovic from Bosnia and Herzegovina in C1 men. who has pulled out the race.
But there's always a plus side. The ice creams at the top are really quite nice, Stefan, so you will be first in the queue for those, I'm sure. So the sun beating down on the lake again. From our commentary position, we can see a load of brown trout swimming in the edge of the lake. The lake is crystal clear. It's shallow for about 10 metres out and then dives down to who knows what depth. Do we know the depth of the lake?
No, it's quite deep, actually. We were out there fixing with the pontons for the camera positions yesterday evening, and it was deep. Really deep. And the water is crystal clear, coming from the glaciers up at the mountain peaks behind us. It's flowing through the lake, and they say that the water in the lake is replaced every 48 hours totally, from the flow of the water from the mountains and downwards to other lakes further down, like in Bled. It's all connected in one system. In these wonderful conditions in the Bochin Valley.
What little wind there was when they started off has died down completely now. Flags are completely still. It's probably quite warm out there for the guys. There is a bit of cloud cover this afternoon, which there hasn't been so far this weekend, but it is warm out there. They will need to drink. There we go, we've got the view of... what is that? Was that the safety boat come in with the...
I think it was the yacht up there at the turning point, actually. There are several positions at the turns where there are yachts that is overlooking the racing so that everything goes nice and smoothly.
So again, Stefan, we got a bit of downtime now while the cameras get themselves organised to see the boys coming back. It's consistently the same teams that are good. Hungary, Spain.
Yes.
I'm going to put Great Britain on that list because Nick Romain's doing so well in this race. Why are the good teams good?
Yeah, say that. I think it's two things. It's numbers and it's tradition. As we said this morning, many nations goes up and down, like Sweden, Denmark, Great Britain, and many others. For a certain period of years, they are very good teams, both in ladies and men, and then it goes down a bit to pick up again after another couple of years. But these nations, Hungary and Spain, have the numbers and enough to always stay in top. And I think they go... It depends a lot for them on the numbers, actually.
Yeah. And from Spain, you often see videos online of national competitions. They seem to race a lot.
Yes.
And which is true in South Africa as well, who obviously, they're not here at the Europeans, but world level, they're the next big team, aren't they?
And absolutely.
The number of domestic competitions certainly seems to help.
Yes, and they have in Spain and South Africa, they have all their traditional marathons, and it's really a lifestyle for them, like cross-country skiing or cycling or whatever in other countries. And in Hungary, canoeing is the second sport to football, so that's why Hungary is good in every discipline in canoeing.
That also means, with the sport being that popular, that they get sort of first pick of the athletes growing up.
Yes.
Whereas, you know, canoeing, kayaking in Sweden and England, canoeing is so far down the list that you don't get first choice. But here come the boys. They're approaching the turn just before the first portage. Still the same group of about 12. Still Nick Romain stays in that V-wash behind the leader. A good clean portage here could see him really make the break into that front group. He's done phenomenally well.
And excuse us for not knowing the names of them. We will do better when we have the technical system, because internet is off now. So we are back to how we did this a couple of years ago, when we didn't have any technical support. So we need to recognize the athletes by numbers and by their technique. And these youngsters, we have not learned the technique yet so good as we have done with the seniors later on. So, but we will manage, and this after finishing this turn, and now we have the C1s on the monitor, and the C1s is in the, at the upper turn, and it's the top group of the C1s, the two Hungarians, and we would prefer now to watch the big group of the K1 men coming into the portage. There they are. Approaching the portage. It's 200 meters more to go before entering the portage.
This is quite, again, another stressful. The first portage is quite stressful. There's going to be a lot of people changing position in the group at this stage. Everyone will come for a fight up the front. The front runners will want to stay at the front, which they're obviously capable of doing, else they wouldn't be there in the first place. But they also don't want to spend everything to get there. So the main two, you've got Spain, yellow nose boat, Hungary, the red nose.
And it is.
And they've really destroyed that group, those front three.
Laszlo Solti,
two Hungarians.
Laszlo Solti is racing in a white tracksuit. And with about with a red nose there, Solti and Rodriguez.
It's all closing up. The first two have got out right at the end of the pontoon, which has made life hard for the others. There's going to be a lot of stress and a lot of people having to wait. So Spanish athlete there made a right pig's ear of that, hasn't he? He came in third, yeah. And look, he's still standing there now as the second group come past him.
It's Sanchez and Solti. Alejandro Sanchez and then Laszlo Solti. Both of them.
And then the second Hungarian also coming in there.
Yes.
It's Adam Petro. These three away. Spain traditionally are not scared of running at the front of a race like this.
And it's Sanchez that jump in quickest. And Sanchez, the silver medalist from last year in Piestany, is in the lead now. And it seems like they have made quite a gap now over the portage. Laszlo Solti and Alejandro Sanchez. Solti, that were third in Oklahoma last year in this category. Also a former junior world champion.
Great Swedish team there.
Over the porches now is also that is.
That's Germany getting in. Denmark. Oh, another swimmer there. There you go. Yeah, he pushed away too soon, got hassled by the athlete behind him, and now he's in the water. That swim's going to cost him minimum 2 minutes, probably.
Yeah.
And it's just not worth it to save 5 seconds. Especially with the juniors and the under-23s. You watch them doing portage practice, and there's so much fancy stuff going on. There's standing up, there's getting in, boats moving. There's all the fancy stuff you can imagine. All the stuff that looks really good when you're on your own and there's no one around you. Then you watch this happen and there's swimmers at each end of the portage and it's just chaos. So some of the tail enders coming into the portage here. 256 from Sweden.
And that is Nils Thoresson.
265 from Slovenia. Needs to pick the nose of his boat up a little bit quicker than that.
And they are about 15th position or so. The other Swedish guy is Emil Torstensson. He was within the second group, around 10.
Portaging basics, as in getting the boat out and getting the boat in, are very simple. When you get the boat out, the nose must be higher than the tail. When you put the boat in, the tail must be lower than the nose. And to watch these guys at European level pick the boat up with the nose lower, then as soon as you go forward, it's in the water or you're trying to lift it up as you run, it just doesn't work. Just take your time, get the basics right before you do anything fancy.
And the reason, it's many reasons for doing that in the right way. One of them is that it's often a little bit of water in the boat. And that if you lean the boat in the wrong direction, the water pulls it even further down. So, and that makes a lot of trouble if you do it the wrong way.
Yep, absolutely agreed. The water runs to the front of the boat.
Yes.
Front of the boat dives back into the lake that you've just picked it out of. And if you run forward, the boat twists round,
yes,
and you've caused all sorts of problems.
So for yourself and for your fellow competitors.
For everyone else.
Yeah.
But to be fair, there's not a lot of sympathy from fellow competitors in that situation.
No.
So the next thing you have is somebody running through your
yes.
boat. And rightly so, because if you're going to cause problems like that, then you need to practice more.
Yes. Destroying for yourself and your fellow
yeah.
competitors is not a good thing to do. So once again, apologize for not having all the positions in order. It's quite impossible without technical system, and the internet is still down here in Buchin, unfortunately. So we are running this just as we did a decade ago, just from paper and our poor heads.
But we have much better commentators than we did a decade ago, Stefan. Now
sure,
it's us,
sure.
And we can lift it, even though we can't see it. It's as if we can.
Yes, we can. To quote someone famous.
Bob the Builder, I believe. Sorry, Stefan, I shouldn't have said that while you had a mouthful of water. I'll be more careful next time. So, yeah, we talked about earlier that the race have changed from long laps or long races to short laps. Other things that have changed over the years, the new skinny boat rules came in, you know, a good few years back now, but it's still different from the era we raced in. Do you think that's made any difference?
I don't think so, not much. These boats are not more unstable than ours were. It's more or less the same, because the body of the boat that is in the water is mostly the same. It could even be so that some of the boats are more stable than ours were.
Yeah.
So I don't think it made a significant difference.
For me, as someone who survived on the washes rather than the actual theoretical speed of the boat, the new skinny boats, they don't find the waves as well. There's not enough volume behind you to pick up the same information that you used to get with the old boats.
Yeah, that could be.
And so I think that's made a difference to the size of the group sometimes. You often see twos, threes, fours where we used to have bigger groups. And I think maybe that is a factor.
That makes sense, absolutely.
But then with the new boats coming out, there's only one out here today, and unfortunately it's not with one of the top guys. It's the new Nello Cinco, which is they've deviated drastically from conventional design there. And that has that same feel. It has a lot of volume behind you, and it has the same feel on the washes as the old-fashioned boats. So for me, in the way I race, that'll be a no-brainer. I'd go for one of the new ones. But yeah, each to his own.
So the Cinco is good also for marathon racing, not only sprint?
Absolutely. Yeah. I had a lot of people telling me it was no good for marathon, so I tried it myself in a training session at our marathon canoe club, if you like. And I think quite possibly the best boat since the skinny boats have been invented for the wash hanging, yeah.
Interesting.
Back to the C2s. That's Bala leading in the blue boat. That's quite handy, B for blue, I think, unless I get it wrong like I did with the Spanish earlier today. And in the red boat, Nagy. And you can be sure they know exactly the other's strengths and weaknesses. They're coming around now for their first portage once they're off this turn. About a minute to go. And in the little insert there, we've got the top group in the K1. Down to three athletes, two Hungarians, one Spaniard. And normal world order is restored in that race.
But that was quite interesting because the two top guys there had quite a gap. So that means that...
The second Hungarian?
Yes.
Did well to catch up.
Adam Petru. And he is a world champ from Rome, so
he's got some form.
Yeah. But it's quite impressive anyway.
But also we've seen over the years, the Hungarians are one team that does do a lot of teamwork.
Yes.
And if his mate didn't help the Spaniard get away, then maybe the Spaniard thought, you know what, we'll wait for him instead. It's just safer. So the Hungarians have always raced together. I remember one of my first races, I raced two Hungarians and they stitched me up big time. We raced in Berlin and I had no chance. They knew exactly what they were doing with me. Great learning curve for me though. I didn't enjoy it at the time. So into the first portage. T 205, yep, Bala in the blue boat and Nagy in the red boat. Both gone to the same side of the landing stage. Nagy out slightly quicker than Bala, up and running. But there's really no rush for either of these two. Just behind them, two Spanish and a Ukraine. Hungarian Portage crew there. Quick squirt of drink. That guy looked like he got confused. He squirted in with the orange drink and tried to feed him the water there. These two are going to be back in nice and safely. Meanwhile, at this front end of the portage, the others have just been out. They're up the ramp now. They should be running across the grass as we speak. But Nagy away well. Carrying his, choosing to carry his drink, the camel back there. Unlike his compatriot Bala, who's decided to pick his drinks up at the portage on each lap.
It's quite close between these groups in the C2 race. And, usually we see changes a lot more between groups in C1 racing than in K1. So this is not done yet, I think.
No, and Spaniards also work well as a team.
Yes.
You know, we've seen that in the men's K2 an awful lot over the years.
Yeah.
Certainly the gloves are off over the finish line in the Spanish team. There's no lasting friendships, but they do work together as a team. Often if crews get away together, they will work together to stay ahead. It's 204, Patrick Gluza from Poland there, and behind him, Czech Republic, Jan Dlouhy. If you were wondering where all the pies had gone, that might be your answer right there. So a bit of a standoff as to who's going to do the lead in there. It's not an uncommon sight, both fishing for their drinks, one after the other. And they'll gradually make progress round together. Meanwhile, the K1s are somewhere up the top end. You see different drink systems there, Stefan. I mean, each drink system has its own benefits, I guess. With a Camelback, you've got your drink with you all the time. It's guaranteed. But when it runs out, maybe you're not organized for a replacement.
Exactly.
And you're carrying something on your shoulders, which which seems so restrictive.
Yeah. I hated that. It's much, much better to be as light as possible.
Yeah.
And I really don't understand why they use this kind of system in this kind of race, where it's so many portages.
Yeah, you got seven opportunities to get a drink.
Yes.
Why would you put a straitjacket on to go and race in? It does seem crazy.
They're hunting grams on the boats and other equipment, but and then carry on with a couple of kilos of water.
A lot of the athletes are choosing to have water poured over them. It must be quite hot out there. Certainly the sun's hidden behind the clouds a bit now, so they've got a bit of relief. So again, he looks like he's got about 5 litres on his back, this fella.
Yeah, exactly. It's also interesting how to blend the liquid when it's hot. It's a big difference to use liquid when it's more cool. You need more water than sugar and the other nutritions when it's warm, and the opposite when it's cool.
Yeah, we spoke about that earlier, how the length of the race has changed the drink systems as well. I mean, no longer do you really need the carbohydrate loading that we had to have for the 3-hour plus events.
Exactly.
So it is all electrolytes and sweat replacement.
Yeah.
And everyone has a different method of doing that.
And we used to say that it is after 2 hours that something really happens in the body. Then you're really need to train the system for nutrition in the body, as well as the strength for paddling. So and now it's about 2 hours, so we don't get that stage anymore on this kind of racing.
And in some ways that's a great loss, yes, because it did separate the field out. I mean, you could be 2 hours into a race and all of a sudden then the race would split to those that were prepared and those that weren't.
Yeah.
And
but on the other hand, we have that kind of racing as well, so...
Yep, so you can choose that, obviously. So the first group just coming up to the turn before the second portage. It's going to be about 3-4 minutes to the portage. View back on screen, back to the C1 race. Two Hungarians followed by two Spaniards, followed by one Ukrainian athlete there. No real change, well, no change in the men's under 23 K1. Salty still leading it out. He's done a lot of leading. Yeah, I know they've only done a couple of laps, but
yes,
he's consistently at the front.
Yes.
So you've got Salty. You've got second Hungarian, Adam Petro. And then Spaniard. I'm not actually sure which Spaniard he is. Have we got more than one in here?
Sanchez.
It's Sanchez, yeah.
Alejandro Sanchez.
So they are the three ones that you would have expected to be up there from the start. And they're not disappointing us. Second group isn't far behind. They're still in with a chance of catching up, but the three quality athletes will probably have control over whether that second group catches up or not. If they want them to, they will. If they don't want them to, then they won't. There's not much
going to stop. It's interesting to watch their technique, paddling technique there. It differs quite a lot.
You're very different body forms. The Spaniard is really quite a short, stocky guy. Salty's quite lanky. In a way, he looks a little bit like Holman paddling there.
Yeah.
It's not dissimilar. So Spaniard opting to come to this side of the landing stage. Two Hungarians going left. There doesn't seem to be any rush.
No, they will secure each other. We'll see how many seconds.
Both boats out
now.
Well. They're up the top of the ramp. They'll be about halfway down, maybe even getting in the boats when the second group come up that same ramp we've just seen them on. Salty running well.
It's 19 seconds. 19 seconds behind now.
So in this second group, we've got Portugal, we've got Germany, and Italy. So I'm not sure if the Italian is Bazzani or Vincenzi. Will try to get a number on him. And out the portage, Salty's not hanging around. Sanchez has gone with him. And just as on the previous portage, it's Petro who's going to have to do the catching up.
And the third group is another 24 seconds behind the second group. So it's 45 seconds between the third group and the top group now. They're in the middle of the portage. Here they are, the third group. And that consists, it's Italy there, it's Great Britain. We recognize nice who is who there.
That's Sam Plummer and Nick Romain. Nick Romain's fallen back a couple of groups since that cracking first couple of laps where he was in control of the best wash in the race.
And it's Pablo Solares from Spain that are there as well.
At this level, Stefan, the Nick Romain guy who we can see in shot there, he did two laps with the front guys, absolutely with the front guys.
Oh.
He left his compatriot Sam Plummer behind. Ultimately, he may come way down the race.
Yes.
To me, that's how you learn. You have to be at the front. You can get 20th place in two ways. You can come from first to 20th, or you can be 20th all the way around.
Yeah.
And you only learn by mixing it with the front guys. For me, Sam Plummer, Nick Romain today, rather, has had an absolute blinder, regardless of the result from this point on.
And the fourth group of three is Emil Torstensson from Sweden. They are about 12th position or so, together with Germany. That is Felix Richter and as well William Peters from Belgium. Emil Torstensson, that is doing his second year as a senior. He participated also last year. the best male marathon paddler in Sweden currently, Emil Torstensson. Young, so we have Sweden has a bunch of youngsters that is here to learn and hopefully will make a success in the years to come.
And are they entered in the senior K2 as well?
Yes, absolutely.
So that's an education, right? Presumably yeah. They're not intending to win the senior K2, yeah. But they've put themselves in a position to learn. And
Emil is very, very ambitious. That. He's training really tough and heading for to be a top athlete of the world within a couple of years. Exactly the focus you should have. Into the portraits is Nils Thoresson, the second Swedish guy.
You see there, he wisely came right up the landing stage, pushed the yellow boat right up to the end where it's hard for him to get out. Either a clever move, let's hope it was, on his part. From the yellow boat there, really, he should have seen that coming and stopped much sooner.
Absolutely.
But they're the patterns you learn as you get older.
Shark from Slovenia. That's a pattern to learn, absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
And I guess really that's the real beauty of this under 23, is it gives the guys a chance to learn before they get into the big league.
Yeah.
And because in the big league, the education is tough, I would say.
It's really tough, and often the experience of these races is that they go too tough in the first laps, and then it's just a nightmare for the rest. To do it this way is you learn a lot better.
Yeah, I think the danger of the under 23 though is that people look at it as a separate class, and really it should be looked at as a stepping stone to the senior. To be the under 23 winner is not an end goal. I don't
think
it's a step to being a real senior. Mm. At the moment, they're just pretending to be seniors, and then the real step.
But it's the same for the juniors.
It is, but yeah, juniors has always been there under 23. Yeah. We've created, and I think if you look at the history of the world champions in the seniors, a lot of them were world champion by the time they were 23.
And now we can see here some of the nature. The sun is heading directly into the camera now, but we do have the mountains in the background in a very, very nice way now. Over 2,000 meters, 2,500, the highest peaks. And I spoke to one of the mountain guides here who is helping organizing this event, and he was stuck in a snowstorm up there last week. So it's could be quite tough in these Alps as well, but it's summertime. It's really, really nice for hiking and climbing and everything here. It's like a Norwegian fjord, but this is even more warm and more friendly nature and more forest. And I don't think they have any trolls here.
Let's hope not, but they do have the gold monster up in the mountains somewhere.
That's right.
They do have the gold monster. So back to the first group. Yeah, what looks from the outside like a casual paddle around the lake seven times here, all the while these guys are looking at each other, aren't they? They know what damage they can do to the other ones. Yeah, if you were the Hungarians here, wouldn't you? You would try and organise to damage the Spaniard.
Absolutely.
If Salty let his friend take the lead now, then where would the Spaniard have to go? He'd have to go around.
Exactly.
So why they don't do that? Instead, the Spanish is taking the lead. Salty's going to drop all the way around up the right-hand side.
But they do it very skillfully. He didn't fell off the wave.
Never fell off the wave. Just two or three strokes to climb back up to the wash. And that's a great exercise to do when you're learning, to come from the back to the side in as fewer strokes as possible. If you can do that in less than 10 strokes, then you've done a good job. If you find yourself climbing over the wave for 20 seconds, then you need to keep practicing.
And the bow should be not more than 10 centimeters or so behind the guy in front. When you do that, then you don't miss the wave. So it's kind of precision to do it.
Okay, I've just given a commentator's penalty point to Adam Petro there for throwing his drinks bag in the water. I don't think commentators' penalty points count for much in the final reckoning, but...
But it is said on the team leader meeting, it was very clear that it's not allowed to throw drinking bags into the water.
Yeah.
Drinking bags is plastic and it's not good at all for the environment.
So we may even have a few drops of rain on the lake out there, Stefan.
Maybe.
Which is quite cooling.
Yeah,
could clear. It'll be nice for the paddlers. Hopefully it won't turn into the thunderstorm that we had last night, but which cleared the air nicely, actually. But a few drops of rain aren't going to upset anyone here.
Rather the opposite, I think.
Yep. So Ballast still leading the C2. They're just coming around to the portage. Well, they're actually just coming up to the turn before the second portage. They haven't pulled too much ahead of the Spanish, who are still within maybe a minute of them.
We'll see now. Using ordinary watches once again, though, to have the timing.
So here they are, they're just halfway around that turn. Fairly relaxed, both left-hand side paddlers. I'm assuming they won't be in the C2 tomorrow.
No, because C2, mostly they have paddlers that paddle on each side of the boat. But we have seen C2s paddling on the same side as well.
Especially in the women's C2 in the sprint at the moment, because I guess the lack of numbers, you have to choose the people who are fast rather than the people who paddle on opposite sides.
And here the rain comes.
So they make their way towards the portage. Very relaxed feel to the lake out there.
It really is. But it looks very relaxed, but it's exhausting anyway to them.
Did we get a time split on the Spaniards, or are you doing that at the portage? At the portage,
okay. Do that.
So it looks like about a minute, maybe a little less even.
A little less, I think. About 45 seconds, we will see now.
Both Hungarians to the same side of the portage again. Bala out first. Nagy a little bit slow getting out, as he was last time. Yeah, maybe there's a few seconds there you could catch up if you're the Spaniards and you're fast. Coming through. Yep. Totally ineffective drinks system there. Trying to squirt a bit of orange juice down him at speed. But the Hungarians are in.
It's 41 seconds.
Just as the Spaniards get out. So they're exactly, as one gets in on one pontoon, the others are out on the other, and they're off. Hungarians got no drink at that portage. Certainly Bala didn't. The other one, as we said, is carrying it with him all times. I don't think the race is long enough for that to become too significant.
No.
But you know, that's another thing that you should have organised. Your crew that are feeding you, that should be a well-drilled thing. I know in the Great Britain team there are certain guys that are trusted to do that, and they do it year in, year out. And
that's
how it should
be. Exactly. And the top teams are all also practising this quite well.
Certain athletes also have their own coaches doing it because they trust. There's an element of trust. They know what it's like to be rushed, to be stressed. And actually, as an athlete, you're really comfortable swearing at your own coach because they'll accept it.
Yeah, exactly.
it's a good opportunity to get a few of your frustrations off your chest, having a bit of a verbal abuse of your support staff.
But it's important. You can't miss. It's only a couple of meters, 20 meters or so, that is possible to provide drinks, and you can't miss. So to be a top athlete and be able to secure that, ensure drinks in a stressful situation with a lot of athletes coming at the same time, you need to practice. And the top guys do that, and as you said.
It's all, the other thing that's quite hard sometimes, when the athlete is stressed and they're worried about their position in the group, often they'll refuse a drink.
Yes.
And then the coaches have to say, whoa, no. Yeah. The drink is an important part of this.
It is.
And sometimes the coach has to be in control rather than the athlete. I've been there myself where you keep refusing drinks because you're in a hurry, and then ultimately you have no drink. But when you realize you've had no drink, it's too late.
But previously it was allowed to deliver drinks anywhere on the course.
Yeah.
So we had always reserve stations along the course to be able to go to the bank and having drinks there.
Again, that was another area where the Scandinavian countries especially were massively well organized.
Yes.
There was that whole era where there had people swimming in the lakes.
Yeah, so that was quite dangerous. Yeah, that's why they changed.
But great fun. I mean,
it was.
You'd be paddling around somewhere, a random place on a course, and all of a sudden there's a head and an arm comes out of the water with someone's drink system, boom, into the boat and off they go.
They were climbing bridges and such things.
And to be, I think that's a great spectacle.
It is.
But there is always the danger of a kayak bow to the head.
Yeah.
And usually there's only one winner in that situation.
Yes. This is much more controlled and safe, of course. And a little bit less fun, but anyway, maybe more fair.
Yeah. I remember one great video from the World Championships in Copenhagen where they were being fed from the water.
Yes.
And there's a video of one of the English guys, Chris Ballard, hitting them over the head with his paddle because they're in his way. You just don't get that entertainment anymore. Okay, here come the men's K1s into their second portage. Or was third portage?
Third
portage.
Still well together, and this is just transportation for them. They know that if they keep on this way, they have secured the three medals. So they are looking behind, of course, and making sure that the second group doesn't come closer. But we have seen, last year we saw a breakout out of three paddlers, but they were paddling really slow and didn't care of the big group coming back, which was quite strange. One of them, Hank McGregor, was beneficial for it, and won anyway, but the others fell off, so they would have been much better for them to keep on going, not letting the big group coming back.
They're really hard decisions. I mean,
it is.
You've got three here, there's no V-wash, there's no real rest. There's an expectation when it's three that you take your turn. Mm. There's no hiding from the work that you have to do. Mm. If the group gets together and it's six, and you're confident, then you can hide in that group and you can get away with doing no work.
Yeah.
And someone who raced in the way I raced, that was quite a relief to me. You could hide at the back and nobody knew you were there. Well, that's how I saw it. Maybe they did know you were there, but
of course, always.
But there are different methods. In Brisbane in 92, after a very short distance, there were just two of us in front. And it was myself and a Dutch athlete. I'll think of his name in a minute.
Tony Benchop,
that's right. And he was shouting at me, now is the time, we can go. We're first and second. And there was no way. He was picking the wrong person.
Yeah.
So we're out of the portage. All together this time. No real stress there for anyone. Spaniard, Sanchez Cabos, chosen to lead out the portage. Salty looking very relaxed, to be fair.
Yeah, very, very.
He's not paddling like a man who's under load there. He's very free.
It's interesting to watch the technique of Sanchez. He's really using the full width of his long arms and using the body in a very, very good way. Second group coming in, and the gap has increased.
So there might be the third group.
Yeah, the second group just already left the portage, and the gap has increased slightly. It's a little bit more than 50 seconds now.
Third group containing both the British athletes. It's uncanny how often in a race like this, the two athletes from your nation end up in the same group. Mm. It's like they expect that to happen. And once they've got their mate with them, they accept that position and they roll with it.
Team racing. And the second group is headed by Miguel Rodriguez. This is the third group entering the water again.
Italian waiting. There's an entire empty side to the pontoon, yes. And he's waiting on the other side.
Strange. 271.
Palmer there. You can't question his endurance. He did the devices to Westminster race earlier this year.
Okay.
And did very well at it. He did especially well in all the preliminary races leading up to it.
I remember him from Piestany last year, where he did a very good race on his own. He finished 12, but as I remember it, he picked up from the bottom and
continued. He's certainly not work shy. He's
a
good athlete. So that group that came in with both British athletes, suddenly it breaks up. Just through a little bit of portage incompetence, Italian now on his own out the back of that, and really he's going to have to work very hard to close the gap he's lost just through standing, waiting at the portage.
Maybe he was tired and just rested a bit there. Looks like he's given up his attempt to close that gap once again. And the fourth group is coming in, Emil Torstensson. Emil together with Belgium and Germany.
That was a nice tidy get out by Emil there. The others are still on the pontoon, yeah. He's gone.
He has practiced that quite a lot.
Extensively.
Yeah.
Who makes him practice that, Stefan?
I don't know, actually.
So he runs reasonably well as well. Socks? Wearing socks? What's your opinion on wearing socks in a canoe race?
I think it's the socks is specially made for running, quick and fast.
I always race bare feet. I don't know about you. You get better sensitivity through the footrest, through the steering system.
Oh, I had some actually ballet shoes.
Very nice too.
Yeah, because it was mostly because the portages could be...
They were quite rough back then.
Could be very rough.
Yeah.
And also long. In the Worlds in 88 in Nottingham, it was one portage that was 400 meters or something like that. Very rough.
I prefer not to remember the World Championships in Nottingham. I like to erase Nottingham from my memory altogether as a place.
It was really rough, a storm coming in and very high water level and very, very windy.
Yeah, that's not something I care to remember. Actually, talking of steering and stuff, we had a question earlier that we couldn't answer at the end of the first session, where somebody asked if any of the boats here were using pedals and an overstern rudder. So I haven't seen one racing yet, but I have seen one in the athlete area. Typically, we don't use the pedals in the marathon canoeing, but they do on the downriver stuff in South Africa. That's the way things are. And Hank McGregor's won the World Championships with pedals and with an overstern rudder. Mm. So do you have anything to add to that, Stefan? Or why would you choose what you choose?
I think... tradition basically, but the pedals could be used for underlaying rudder,
the one at the back or the understern rudder.
The pedals could be used for any rudder, but the reason people don't use pedals so much is that you use the legs a lot, you use the feet, and it's difficult to to have enough good footrest with the pedals.
The South Africans obviously don't suffer that, though.
Exactly.
They've grown up with that system, and they use it very effectively.
And the Overstern rudder is a bit slower, actually. It creates more resistance in the back of the boat. I was very surprised when Hank used it. It used to be, if you count in knots, it used to be 1/4 knot slower with a Overstern rudder.
But then if it's equipment you're familiar with, then it's always a good idea to race and run with equipment you're familiar with.
Yes.
So my argument against the pedals is the same as yours. You can't get the pressure on the footrest. But then maybe that's just because we've grown up with the other type of footrest.
I've used it several times in sea kayak racing.
The surf skis all use pedals. Mm. And they're when you need the more extreme steering sometimes. I think maybe pedals have a value.
Yes, yes.
And that would be the same with the downriver racing as well, where you need more
when the waves when waves goes up to 2-3 meters and you're surfing there, both in kayaks and surf skis, you need to be very, very quick on the pedals, and it's great beneficial to have the pedals there.
But the fine movement of the tiller bar, the traditional tiller bar, I think is much more...
Yes. A lot better.
It's a lot more refined system.
Yes.
And you can have the gearing altered by the size of the wheel at the back of the boat or the length of the tiller bar. You can do whatever you like with it.
Yes.
But it's amazing how many people's boats you see where the wires are slack.
Yes.
And the rudder's not in the middle. Mm. And they're your basics.
Yes.
If you can't steer your boat, you can't control your boat. And if you can't control your boat, there's no way you're going to function in a group event like
this. Exactly. And you never see it among the top guys.
No.
And the top guys, if you really look into their boats, it's a lot of small details that is specific for them.
Yeah.
And they put a lot of attention to it.
Mind you, I have known athletes who've put so many small details into their boat, they go over the top with that. And eventually they confuse themselves. I don't know if you remember back to Duncan Blythe from the Great Britain team. Man, there was always something.
Yes.
You know, it was he used to carve his seat out of a tree with a penknife the day before. And you know, it was just extraordinary. Got overly complicated systems going.
Back then we used wave breakers on the deck boats. Because the front of the boats were so low. It was always different type of wave breaks.
Yeah, half a plastic bottle was always the favourite. But the boats have changed over time, not only with the width restriction going, but the volume in the front is, you don't need that anymore. You don't see people race with spray decks anymore.
No.
I know part of that's due to the fact they portage every 4K now, but even in the longer races, a pump is used more often than a spray deck. Back in the day, you'd be taping around your spray deck, sometimes even using two spray decks on the bigger races where the water could get bigger. All that's
still used in the classic marathons, of course.
Tour de Gudner and stuff.
This was a good example of how the drinking bags is working. They are hanging these bags around the neck. Basic stuff.
Oops.
Oh, it's slippery on the pontoon.
You spoke too soon. Commentator's curse there, Stefan. The pontoons, they're quite strange. They're a floating pontoon, plastic. And the water makes them slippery for one, but they also move a little bit when you run onto them. So if you've got tired legs, or even worse, unlucky enough to have a dead leg that's not working, when you hit those pontoons, there's quite a high chance of you having an error of some sort.
That was Alex Barta from Finland.
He's got a lonely journey home from there. There's no company either in front or behind him that's going to be of any use to him. Okay, round come the C1s. Bit of a development in the C1 race. You've still got the two Hungarians at the front, but behind him, the Spaniards have gone their separate ways, and it's going to be down to just one man to close these two down, if it's going to happen at all. He's still within striking distance. You wouldn't be saying that if it was a kayak race, but C1's, as Stefan said a couple of times already, things are just different. And it's not unheard of for a lone C1 to catch a pair of guys, even if they are working well together. But Bala leading, as he has been most of this race. Nagy content just to sit with him. So this, I think, is the third portage for the C1s.
Fourth.
I've always struggled with the laps, Stefan. I think it's a small brain problem.
Like the seagulls, one too many. Same for me.
This is the end of the fourth lap for the C1s. Thank you for the information coming into our headphones.
From Brian Chapman.
So the end of the fourth lap means it's their third portage.
And for the K1s, it's the end of the fifth lap. Next time they come here.
They'll be coming around for their fourth portage.
Jim Rossiter, that is counting the laps and doing the commentary on the venue here.
Jim Rossiter, part of the marathon canoe racing furniture, really. It's been here for as long as the sport itself, and possibly longer.
Yeah, I saw a picture from him from mid-70s, when he was a youngster and were among the guys that formed the ICF Marathon Committee.
Okay.
Together with Jörn Kronberg, who is still the chairman of the committee, and Ruud Heisler and Alan Lohs.
All of whom are still here to this day.
Yes, they've been there for 40 years plus.
I'm sure there are arguments both ways over over that.
Yeah, but they have their heart in the sport. And
they're always there. They always do a good job. The events are always well organized. So first Spaniard out, just as the Hungarians get in. It's going to be a long journey on his own, but there's still a long way to go. We're only about halfway through this race. Here he is in shot now. Running reasonably well. Was given his drink system. And off he goes. In the C1, Stefan, it's quite nice to see they've adopted the Lycra shorts ahead of the Speedos these days. Speedos were always, the little trunks were always a little bit disturbing when you were watching a canoe race, but now dressing more appropriately for the conditions. Yeah. It's a relief to all of us. Okay, Ukraine now coming in at the entrance to the portage, and we get another long view there of the mountains. Just before we come on to Ukraine, who's gradually but relentlessly being caught by the two athletes behind him, who are going to close him down over the next lap, I'm pretty
sure. Which is Poland, Patrick Lusa, and Jean Louis.
And in come the K1s for their fourth portage.
They have increased the gap slightly to the second group. So they're not going that slow.
Already divided to go either side of the pontoon from quite a long way out, to be fair.
It is.
I think partly that is because this right-hand side of the portage, you need to come into it at a better angle. It's not set straight with the course. But there's no real, there's no, definitely not an effort to break the group up here. It's all very well controlled. Hungarians being good to each other. First one in went short, second one long.
Very good. Portage from Sanchez, and he's a good runner as well.
Watch the drink system here for Sanchez, going over his neck, just going over there. That's simple, well organized, simple. Same for the Hungarian.
And now there are two more laps to go. And two portages to do.
See Salty, a bit slow getting in, but no real stress. And you can see nobody's in massive hurry to get away from there. They're happy just to cover the distance. And they'll do their fighting at a later stage.
And the second group, it's Portugal, Miguel Rodriguez, together with Marcel Poufler.
It's Rodriguez we can see there. Portuguese traditionally run well, right from the time back from Rui Cancio, who used to run like a Portuguese rabbit. I mean, he's unstoppable. And now Romalo, the same, also can run away from a group.
Rui Cancio is now the Portuguese team manager, the Portuguese team coach.
But so he still believes he's the best paddler there.
for sure. That will never leave him. So this is Miguel Rodriguez, 262, and Marcel Poufler from Germany, 267.
I imagine both of those will be fairly disappointed they're not mixing it with the front group.
Absolutely. Third group coming in, and that is Spain, easily recognized by the red tracksuits and their Helio boats.
And the two great Brent athletes. Sam Plummer, the slightly bigger hair of the two. Nick Romain, nice and tidy out of that portage. A little bit slow getting his boat out there.
It's Pablo Solares from Spain that is leading that group, together with Plummer.
No drinks for Plummer there, just a bucket of water over the head just to cool him down a little bit. Both these guys have run very well. They've made quite a gap on the other two.
Yes.
Even though everyone was out together pretty much, Plummer just could have used a couple of extra feet on that pontoon to paddle away, but he's away well, away cleanly. And again, the Italian stands and waits.
Yes, strange.
To do it one time is kind of forgivable. To do it twice, maybe we should go and make a cup of tea and have that ready for him at the next one while he stands and waits. We can give him a cup of tea, make the wait worthwhile for him. So big gap there from Plummer.
Yeah, very good jump into the boat from Plummer.
That's four or five lengths comfortably. Nick Romain struggling to catch up the Spaniard, but he is doing it in a very positive way.
But I think Plummer will go now. He's very strong. Yeah, it's his territory. Absolutely, very strong in the end of the races.
He's a good time trialer. All the events I was saying in the lead up to the Devizes to Westminster, they're all time trial races.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah, he's confident in his ability. You do wonder how much wind resistance would be reduced if he cut his hair, though.
Oh, yeah.
there's got to be a couple of miles an hour right there. In fact, he's just put his paddles down and stopped out there. You didn't see that on screen. A couple of seconds there, pick up his drink maybe, or maybe just to wait for the others. He's back up and moving again now, though. As on screen, we have the two front C1s. Status normal there, taking it in turns. Tail enders in the K1, still coming through.
Fourth group then, I think they are position 11, 12, 13. Emil Torstensson.
We're not going to get to see him get out. He got out very well last time. It might be worth watching if we get to see him again. I'm watching him from the commentary tent, and yeah, beautiful job. Nice and tidy. You just missed it on screen, I think. But yeah, very well organized.
Doing a good run there, together with Felix Richter.
And water over his back. Chose not to take a drink. Still got some on his backpack, I'm guessing.
And Pablo Solares. No, it's a Belgian guy there. William Peters, I think it was.
Classy get in by the German there. A little bit risky if you're in a crowd, but he pulled it off well. Getting into a moving boat is not an easy job to do. He styled it out, and he's come out of it fairly well.
We haven't seen anyone practice this just throwing the boat into the water and jumping into it. Very few paddlers can do that, but I saw both Hank McGregor and Len Jenkins doing it the previous World Championships.
Yeah, but you also in Rome saw Hank McGregor put his boat in upside down
at
the end of the portage.
Sure,
you know?
It's risky.
There's always risk, and you have to weigh that risk up against the gain that you can possibly make.
Absolutely.
And yeah, and that all depends on how stressed you are in the environment you're in.
Mm.
Yeah,
or what you want to achieve, actually.
Yeah. If you're not going to leave them behind when you get in, then there's no point getting in
first. Exactly. Exactly.
So you have, there's so much to weigh up. There's so much thought goes into it.
And you must develop a tactic that is suitable for your strength.
Yeah. I mean, getting in early from a portage and paddling off would have been zero use to me.
Mm. But to me, it would have been
quite handy. Yeah, it's a time when you could have done damage to the rest of the field, and it's well worth doing.
I developed that technique for myself, jumping into the boat.
Right.
Practiced and said to myself that if I do it 98 times successfully out of 100 on training, I'll do it on the worlds.
Wow.
And I did, so I had to do it. It was fun, great fun.
And I was unaware of that all that time. I did.
It was back in the 90s.
I was there.
Yeah. But not in K1, in Copenhagen, I think.
Copenhagen? No, that's...
And now that's Nils Thoresson, 256, the Swedish guy. First year under 23, he was participating in the Junior World Championships in Oklahoma last year, and also at the Europeans in Piestone as a junior last year.
Another drink refusal there. Running very well. He's running with intent there. That's someone who's running to get away from someone, right?
Mm.
So he's obviously made his decision. He's going to try and leave his competitor he came into the portage with. He's getting in now. This guy did really well. He emptied his boat out on the run.
Yeah.
And he hasn't lost too much ground despite emptying it out.
It's Jani Žark from Slovenia. And he's
quite
using
calm. To empty a boat out. How many times do you empty a boat out? All the water's at one end. You turn it upside down, but you're not patient enough to wait for the water to come out. So you stop, you turn it over, and carry on with the boat still full of water.
Yeah, but the appropriate way to do it is to take the boat on the shoulder and then tip it back and forth when you're running. That requires some practice, but it's absolutely possible to do.
If you hold the footrest, you can play the boat like almost like a trombone.
Yes.
And tilt it forward, bring it backwards, and that is definitely the way to go. I love this shot when we look down the lake to those mountains. That is amazing.
It's coming in some clouds in the upper end of the lake now. We are on a quite high altitude, and the fog is coming and going up there and at the other end of the lake. But here, it's warm and sunny.
It's actually a place where two weather systems meet, apparently. You've got the Mediterranean weather system and then the Alpine weather system. Mm. They meet here. So it's quite unpredictable weather. And... makes for an interesting day, I imagine, sometimes, especially in the winter.
And last year, when we were here at the World Cup, it was the same weather. Perfect conditions for kayaking. But asking the guys here, they said that 60% of the days it's windy and it could be also rainy. So I think we're lucky. But luck comes with hard work. So Maybe yeah. they've worked enough to gain
maybe
this.
The weather gods have seen the work that's gone into this, Stefan, especially on our part.
For sure.
Okay, that was that group that was four. It would definitely the Italian is. Oh no, maybe not. There he is. He has caught up after all. That's a lot of hard work just to end up back where you started.
Yes,
though.
Unnecessary to pull off or to lose.
That much distance.
Yes.
Yeah, it looks like he's back where he started, but his tanks are that little bit emptier than they could be, and that all adds up towards the end of a race. They'll start to work out who's good and who's bad in that group coming into the later portages. A bit of downtime for us at commentary here. Everyone's up the far end of the lake. It's the leaders going around the top turn on screen now.
On their sixth lap, so it's one more full lap to go. So now they are just trying to save strength for the finish. And it will be another very decisive last portage, I think. I would be very surprised if anyone try anything before the final portage.
Having the portage that close to the end kind of dictates that that's how the race is going to be run now.
Yes.
Do you think we could change that, or do you think that's a good thing, bad thing?
I think it's quite a good thing, actually. It makes the last portage very, very decisive and very interesting to watch.
Does it bring too much of an element of chance?
Could be. But on the other hand, if you practice also this part quite good, it will survive.
Yeah.
First time we did it was in Vaxholm in the Worlds 1996. It was a lot of discussion on it beforehand, but it turned out very well. But there it was beach.
That was a really nice portage there. I mean, I raced there, and you did that portage how many times? Four times, I think.
Yeah.
And just to emphasize your point about it's there and it's the last one. I did K2 there, and the only portage we came out first was the last one, and that's actually the only one that really matters in terms of a result. Oh, look at that.
Internet is working again. Wonderful.
So we've got the split times on the screen. It's not news to any of us. We know where they all are, but it's nice to have that confirmation. So on screen now, you've got that lead group in the background. Petro, Salty and Sanchez. Not in that order, it's actually Sanchez, Petro and then Salty, as you see them there. Salty, the boat with the red ends, white shirt, probably favourite?
Yes, I think so.
Should it come to the last bit?
I think so.
All together?
But also Rodriguez seems to be very strong, so. But Salty looks very confident. Sanchez is not Rodriguez, of course. Sanchez is also there.
Yeah. So C2 is coming up for their fourth portage.
Out of six.
And that's a roll of thunder in the background there. Might be a little bit exciting for the last couple of laps. We get a bit of thunder and lightning on the lake. What's the policy for lightning on the lake then, Stefan?
Policy for lightning is to we always need to make sure that it is safe racing. So when it is a risk for lightning, the jury need to take a decision if the race should continue or if it should be abandoned.
Right. If they were to abandon the race, could they get word to the athletes that okay, now is the next lap is the last lap or the short lap?
Yes, something like that. It's a hard decision to take.
It'd be quite an exciting decision to take, and the thought process change for the athletes would be huge.
Yes, yes. We had a situation in Singapore at the Worlds 2011 when a thunderstorm came in quite fast, and all the athletes were out there at the course, and the decision made then was that we won't gain any safety to abandon the race because they were out on the course. Better let them, because it was just two laps to go, or one lap actually.
So in come the Hungarians. Look to me like Nagy in the red boat is moving slightly better. He looks a little bit smoother coming in. Neither of them are in a hurry particularly still, but Nagy was definitely looked the stronger of the two on the water just coming in there. And it's been quite interesting, the next one. These K1s are going to arrive not far behind the C1. So Hungarians there in shock, getting sprayed with water. A little bit of a drink.
And Salty looks very, very confident and very calm. He doesn't look tired at all. He has done most of the job himself during the race as well. And Sanchez is using the same tactics as the previous lap, going on his own on the right hand side. Speed increases slightly into the portage. Maybe they are trying something here.
I think they'll be worried that the C1 is just in front of them.
Yes.
So they've got an element of danger introduced to this portage. They've got one more obstacle. They're very aware of that. They will have seen that coming from 2 or 3 minutes back.
Yes.
They're working out, trying to decide. Salty,
once again, a wonderful technique, jumping out of the boat. Didn't use his hands on the ponton at all. Just racing in the boat and jumping out of it and running very, very quick. Very good portage technique from Sanchez. And his short legs is carrying him very quick over the...
And because he gets out on the right, he's got the quickest getting in position as well.
And watching him getting into the boat, also very, 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 very quick. Very good portage technique from him. It's Sanchez and it's Salty now. And Petro is also there together with them.
Yeah, it's difficult. You tend to think of Petro as the one guy who's just there making up the numbers.
Yes.
But we still haven't seen anyone tested.
Exactly.
We still don't know who would win on a head-to-head. Yeah. That running's looking uncomfortable. That's a dead leg right there, isn't it? That's a leg that's not working too well for the Italian. He's not running well at all.
Oh, he has some pain now.
Yeah. He's got more pain now.
Yes, much more.
his coach is trying to cheer him up, but that only makes the pain worse usually, doesn't it? Yeah. Cheerful words when you're not in the mood for cheerfulness, that's no help to anyone. So he's getting in his boat. Looking behind, see if there's any help coming. Stopping for another drink. It's always tempting to stop for a drink when your arms are that tired, isn't it?
Yeah.
You think that maybe that rest will help you out, but it doesn't. It's not a rest that's long enough to make any difference. And
not at all.
You have to get back to work straight away.
Yes. Yep. The third group coming in now. We are back to four in that group.
Let's see if we'll get the same thing here. This second Italian athlete here usually runs to the end and waits for the others to get in before he gets in. He's very polite. So, quick bucket of water over the head for Plummer there to keep the hair under control. Spaniard running well. Nick Romain still moving well.
Solaris.
And the Italian. Spain. Italian's got his boat in the other hand this time, though, yes. So maybe he doesn't have to wait too long.
No. He learned, finally.
No.
No. He's moving aside.
So...
It was interesting.
So, having got the boat on the right side that he needed it on, he changed sides because he missed the weight. He needed to wait. We should have had the tee. And plumbers away again. I mean, that's another big gap. It just shows you how much efficiency in portaging can help you out. Yeah, that Italian, if he wants to catch again.
There it is now. It is 49 seconds now between the first and second group. 49, so... It's pretty much the same distance as it was
From the second lap.
Yeah, from the second lap.
But then there is no need for those front three to make that gap bigger. That gap's only important to those second group.
And then it's another minute to the third group.
But number six there, Bazzani. Well, the sixth place there, rather, Bazzani, he's going to be caught by that group at some stage. Again, coming out of that portage, Plummer's made a bit of a run for it. Two behind him, Romain and the Spanish athlete, don't even seem to be working together particularly to catch him. They seem separate.
Yes.
And the Italian has got a bigger gap again this time. It's going to be tough for him. Slovakian now coming through the portage. Drink over the head, quite nice and efficient there.
Ines Matuc from
Slovakia.
Slovakia, okay.
And then about another 30 seconds until the next group reaches the portage. Germany, Belgium, and Sweden.
And the top group in the upper turn. And now it is actually Petru in top there. So after this full lap, they just have to do one more portage, and that will be the final decisive portion. After that portage, it's just 500 meters more to pedal. And for the first time, as I've seen recognized in the race, it's Petru Adam Petru from Hungary, heading the group of three. So we'll see if he just stayed there, quite anonymous, and saved strength to the final 500 meters after the portage.
Very often on the last lap or around that sort of time, they will have a big fight to see who's the fastest. And it's at that stage you have to make the decision whether you're still trying to win the race or whether you're trying to come second now. And often the person who tries to win will end up coming third if they get their judgment wrong. So if they've had a dust up out there somewhere and you realize you're not going to be the winner, then you have to change your whole plan to come second now. But these guys have raced enough now. They should be almost fully educated. They've still got the education to come from the main senior race, which is a tough one, but they've raced enough to know what they're doing.
Absolutely. But that doesn't ensure that you don't make mistakes when the brain is
tired
and
under load, a little bit of stress. And you do see some bizarre decisions sometimes.
Yes. I've even seen the top pilots making the wrong turn in the turning, in the final turn,
right.
when they were very, very exhausted.
Yeah. Some of the tail enders coming into the portage on screen. Guy in the yellow boat last time, having taken his boat out badly like that last time, he still managed to empty it on the run and get in with the other guys, which was quite impressive. But again, you see him there, he gets the boat out nose down.
Yes.
It's just a problem then.
Too much water in it and...
Yeah, and there's no coming back. Holidaymakers there. This is obviously a local holiday spot, isn't it?
It is.
It's nicely equipped for beaches and grass and clear water, you name it. Perfect place to come. .259 there, De Brabander from Belgium. Also, just the one lap to go.
Nils Thorsson from Sweden and Chani Shark from Slovenia.
And William, I think maybe William Peters there. It looked like he'd maybe called it a day and stopped. I know he's still moving. So it's back to the third group of K1s there, catching up the tail enders of the C1. And everyone's up the far end of the course again for us. That's the top turn. Nick Romain leading that group of four. It's all got back together again. Sam Plummer didn't capitalise on the lead he had. And that'll be a judgment decision on his part.
The top three in the turn. Just a kilometer from the portage now. It's a little turn there, not a big one, but a little one, and it is Salty that is in command, holding the initiative.
You see the groups now. A lot of the groups. The group in picture is perfect example. They're all just slowing down now. So it's stopped being a journey to get to the end. Now they're deciding who's going to come where in that group. And it just becomes a bit of a waiting game, bit of cat and mouse, deciding who's going to go where, who's going to do what. And they've totally forgotten now the boat's in front of them and the boat's behind them. For them now, it's a new race of four people.
Exactly. And it's a race of three people in the top group, and they are approaching quite soon here. And Jim Rossiter made sure that we have counted the portages right. We are like seagulls, but he has always the experience enough to keep track of all the laps and portages. So we are now, they are now heading for their final portage.
So coming down to this final portage, Stefan, what, 2.5k to go maybe to the portage? What are you thinking in your head if you're one of those three? What do you need to know?
I would have recognized the precise strengths and weaknesses of my fellow competitors. And I would have tried to use my strength, which was endurance. So I would have gone really, really quick, as fast as possible, really using the full potential of my body to keep keep up the speed into the portage, trying to get the people on the wash exhausted enough so that I could create a gap over the portage using very, very well practiced portage technique and just go for it. And I think you would have done the opposite.
Not similar. So I would at some stage now, they've got about 1,000 meters to go to the portage. Some stage now, I would want the lead. And that'd be the first time, ideally, that I'd led for the entire race, if possible. Mm. And that would be the deciding race out there now, 1,000 meters to go, as to who's going to win the race. The portage is a bit of a complication in that, but I would like to arrive at the portage first now. It just limits the risk, and it gives you at least half a second of error on that portage. Coming into that portage, I'd like to get out cleanly, obviously, in cleanly the other end, and just my only goal would be to maintain that half a length lead. I don't need to increase it, I don't need to lose it, is the key, really. So yeah, I'd like to come into this portage first.
Do you think they have a precise race plan, these guys?
I don't think you can in marathon, can you? It's so difficult. They know their strengths. They know how they're going to cover this distance. They know what they can do. But there's no counting for what the other athletes are going to do to you. You can't make the assumption that you're the fastest. If someone, especially at this level, under 23, where it's new people each time, you don't necessarily know them all. We were racing senior and racing it for so long, you get to know the other people.
Yes.
So we can make a better judgment. But it's they're nervous right now, aren't they? 500 meters to this portage, they're all nervous. They're as nervous now as they were just before the start. Stomachs are going. They know that a mistake here is expensive.
Yeah, but that kind of nervousness is quite beneficial for them. They are building up adrenaline. And the only time when these guys got really nervous is when they don't get nervous into this portage.
Yeah.
Because they really need the adrenaline coming from it for a final move here into the portage.
It's interesting to see that it is... I've lost the names now. But it's not Salty and it's not the Spaniard leading.
It's Petro
leading.
Pedro.
So,
and he also had a lead at the upper turn. I think he really tries to be in control here. He has been quite anonymous over the distance, so we'll see now. But it is looks like it is... Sanchez that is keeping up the speed now and trying at his right hand side, and we know his strength in the portage. He's very, very good portage technique, and he's running very quick as well. Salty rests on the wash there. He's just relaxing, as it seems, and playing pretty cool.
He's relaxing, but he's going to have second choice of where he gets out on the portage.
Exactly.
He's not got first choice there. Spaniard will come this side again, I'm sure, because he has done every other lap. Petro will go left, I'm thinking, because he has on all the other laps, and he's speeding up, and he looks confident.
He
responded immediately to the Spanish acceleration. Salty, now he's going. Now Salty goes.
This will be very interesting how the Hungarians manage this, and the Salt is now passing, and it's Sanchez and Petro side by side in this final portage. Sanchez and Petro side by side in this final portage. It's Sanchez that is running very, very quick. Hungarians side by side. And it's Sanchez, Spain in the lead, out now on the last 500 meters. Very good technique there from Spain. Oof. And he has a both length now, and it's Petro. And it's Spain, it's Petro. maybe Salty is paying now a little bit on all the work he has been doing over the long distance, because now it's Sanchez.
Sanchez, and he's looking strong. Petro's with him. They're all with him.
Yeah, they're all with him.
The last 10 seconds into the portage, Salty was good. Okay, he came around. But why? Why didn't he come in first?
Yes.
You know, you have to question that. Either he's so confident in his last 50 meters
yes.
that
yes.
he's happy there, or he's just made a mistake.
Maybe he's just feeling very, very confident. And now he's trying to rest a little bit on the backwash there behind his teammate Petro and behind Sanchez.
It would be great if the cameras could pick those three up all the way to the finish now, really.
Yes, absolutely. This is very, very interesting.
They're going away. Salty is taking his time to catch up. In fact, I don't think he hasn't really
he
got
hasn't
back
really,
in control.
No, exactly.
He's just dangling off the back of the group, so I think he's struggling.
Yeah,
in fact,
maybe
the gap might be opening now.
Absolutely, he's struggling now. He's paying for all the tough work he have been doing over all the laps. He have been staying in top of the race almost all the race through, doing all the hard work, and now he's paying for that because now it's Sanchez and Petro. Sanchez and Petro, and if we could have the camera on to the in-sprint there, it would be really, really good.
Okay, they're just entering that top turn, which is only, a couple of minutes away, if that, from the finish. We're looking at C1's portaging on screen. I bet you're loving that as the crowd outside. But they are all together again at the top turn. They come around, it's the Spaniard leading from the two Hungarians. They're all together though. And it's tense up there, it is.
Here they are now. And they're all together once again. And Salty is coming back.
Petro, I think.
It's Petro on the inside. And now it's full speed. It's full speed. It's Sanchez, it's Petro, and it's Salty. They're all side by side. And I think Salty is a little bit behind, but he has not given up this. Yes, definitely not giving up, and he is switching side now.
Petro is leading, Sanchez on his right as we look at them.
But Salty is coming now. Salty is coming really, really strong on the left-hand side. It's Petro and it's Sanchez. Petro is leading. It's Sanchez on the outside, and it's Salty on the inner side here.
There goes Salty. Salty, this is his big effort for the front, and Petro's responding. It's just about who can. Sanchez is off the back of these two now. It's Hungary 1 and 2. Petro in the red boat. Salty with the red nose there on his boat.
And it's Hungary, and it's Hungary, and they're just going for it now, and it's Salty.
And that's Salty.
Salty, we thought he was off, but he was confident enough just to rest a bit up to the turn, trusted his great speed, and now he's heading for the goal.
Yes, very much look like the race is over. Salty, as we saw coming into this port, he had a good turn of speed. Very confident race from him.
And the European champion for under 23 is Laszlo Salty. Laszlo Salty, well worth. He is doing a lot of work over the long distance, all the seven laps. And silver also to Hungary by Adam Petro. And Spain by Sanchez. He has another bronze medal here today.
You have to feel for Sanchez there. He did everything right. He had got out of the last portage first. He came around the last turn first. We just didn't have the speed to match these guys.
Exactly. They were simply better.
There's nothing you can do with people who are better than you. But he did everything
exactly
within his power to give the best result he
exactly
could. Should be pleased with his race there. That's good effort from the Spaniard.
A very, very fair race. It was no struggling in any portage or in any turns. They were really showing great sportsmanship, and the best guy won.
C2s are also coming down. The C1s, rather, sorry. Coming down the final 200 meters. Hungary and Hungary again. Gold and silver for them. Just behind the fourth and fifth place in the men's K1. It's really hard to see anything with the sunlight as it is on that camera. It's another turn up. Looks like Portuguese from the German. And it is.
It's Miguel. Miguel Rodriguez, who has fourth position, very, very close to Marcel Puffler, who was seventh last year and now fifth. So
See, when they came into sight from the commentary tent, which is just beyond the start line, they were both together, so it's very hard to tell. I don't know what view you had on the cameras there, and in come the C1s. Bala in the blue boat, remember, Bala, Nagy in the red boat.
It's Bala in the lead, and it's Bala who might win this. Yes, it is. It's Levante Bala, who is the European champion for C1 under 23. And silver is to Balázs Nagy, also him from Hungary. So double Hungary, both in men K1 and men C1 here this afternoon.
That just adds to their massively impressive medal tally over the years. Hungary have taken so many medals in these competitions that it's almost not news for them anymore. It must be quite tough.
It is.
Here comes Sam Plummer.
Sixth.
He's made the break from his group. Nick Romain just behind him, along with second Spaniard. Nick Romain giving it a good effort at coming past. It's going to be tight, but no, it's just not to be. So Sam Plummer, across the line now. Great race from him.
The best international race for him ever, I think. He finished sixth.
And Nick Romain just behind him.
And seventh.
Big shout out for both of them.
Seventh was Pablo Solares from Spain, and eighth, Nicolas Romain.
Across the line now from Italy. 261.
Ninth, Bassani, Francesco Bassani, Italy.
Followed by his compatriot, 258.
Tenth, and that is Filippo Vincenzi.
And the third C1, most of the race on his own, from Spain, number 203.
Vega, Carlos Vega, who has the bronze medal in the men C1.
So honours equal in both races then. Gold and silver to Hungary, bronze to Spain.
The two biggest nations in Europe in marathon racing took the medals here. It would be nice if the producer can put the automatic result system up in the screen now.
You can see the potential for this lake to pick up when the wind gets strong. There's small white caps out in the middle there. But the waves are still very manageable. There's nothing that's going to upset any of the paddlers here today. Results up there now. Salty, Petro, Sanchez, Rodriguez, Paufler, Plummer, Solares, Romain, and Bazzini are the paddlers that are in so far. If you're the Hungarian coach, you're probably feeling pretty pleased with yourself right now.
Yes. Robi, who is organizing the World Championships in Győr in Hungary in September.
Clearly doing a great job with their athletes. Second Spanish C1 over the line now, fourth place. 206.
It's Quintans Gonzalez, or Damien Gonzalez, rather.
Spanish are a commentator's nightmare. They have so many names.
Yes.
263 from Slovakia. Just come over the line.
Finishing 10th or 11th. And that is Filip Sprushanski, Slovakia.
And in the C1s, 204.
Finishing 5th. Patrick Glosa, Poland, who has been around for a while, we have seen him on marathon courses many times, and this is one of his best results.
So just waiting for the minor places to come in. And it's been a great afternoon's racing. I mean, there was everything in that under 23 race. We had a big group to start with. It broke down to a tactical race between the three main contenders. And coming out of the portage wasn't the final result. The final result changed down the last 200 meters. And I think everyone should have learned something from that.
Absolutely. And
the next three finishers coming in the K1 just now, with the shot we've got, it's very hard to identify them, but we'll identify them as they come across the line for you. I'll read out the numbers. 255.
It's Emil Torstensson from
then
Sweden.
264.
Finishing 11th. 264 is Felix Richter from Germany.
And then 254.
Belgium. On the, I think, 14th position, and that is William Peters.
And these guys have
well
probably
done
come
from
through all the junior racing
exactly.
Already. Now into the under 23s.
So they are gaining experience, and they are youngsters, all of them.
And to be fair, even bad experience is still experience.
Absolutely.
Isn't it? Even if you haven't had your best day out there, things haven't gone your way, there's still stuff to be learned from that.
Absolutely.
Probably so more.
Yes.
To be learned from a bad day, hatefully. But
probably these guys doesn't recognize a 12th in the Europeans as a bad result. They are youngsters, and they are developing successively over the years. They might be pleased with the race. Regardless of the result.
253 from Denmark crossing the line now. The result is actually a poor guide as to whether you're pleased or not. You know where you expect to come, you know what
exactly.
Your expectations are. Anyone who exceeds their own expectations will go home from this event happy.
And that was Nikolai Mørke from Denmark, who was among the top guys during the first 1,000 meters.
Yeah. We got the Ukrainian C1 coming in next. He's across the line now. 209, Andriy Bzyli. He's had a tough day out there today. That's commitment from Ollie Harding, the photographer there, up to his waist in water. You've got to admire a man who's prepared to do that, Stefan.
Ah, that's great.
That's commitment to your profession right there.
Absolutely. We'll see more of that.
So hopefully he's getting some good shots for the publicity and stuff afterwards and for the teams themselves. 270 coming in there. Szczepanik from Poland. He's looking like he's spent pretty much everything out there today. He's come through. And he looks like he's going to be pleased to get back to the safety of the boat sheds.
Sorry?
259 across the line from Belgium. De Bram van Der. And 202, Czech Republic in the C1. Jan De Luy. Just towards the end of the racing now. Some of tomorrow's athletes who are competing tomorrow, going out for their warm-ups. Slovenian athlete, Jani Jark, 265, coming in. Bit of learning to do on his part, but some of his Portage skills were as impressive as some of the others were unimpressive. So he's had a good day. Looks like one of the younger paddlers in the race as well. So I'm sure he'll be back for more in the future.
Šanišark, Slovenia. 265. I think he's using a sprint boat, actually.
As in sprint weight?
Yeah, sprint boat, weight yeah. boat.
That might explain why he struggled to get it out of the water, to be fair.
Yeah. Marathon boats is 8 kilos, about 8 kilos, while sprint boats are 12.
That 4 kilos feels heavier and heavier on each lap.
Yeah.
Next C1 coming in. 210, second to the Ukrainian team. To be fair, I'm not even going to try and pronounce his name. We'll just settle for the Ukrainian. Too many K's and Y's in there. Either you can give it a shot, Stefan, if you like. You're more practiced than me.
Oh yeah.
But Prikhodko.
Yeah.
Not bad.
Not bad. Mikhailo Prikhodko. Ukraine.
He's glad to get off his back knee, look, straight down, give himself a little bit of a rest. Dunk the other leg in the water, cool that off. And we're being treated to another moody skyline shot from the photographers here. You can't blame him for that one. Another beautiful shot of the background.
And there is the finish final result, the unofficial final result. The official final results will come later on, but this is how it
this appeared to be
regarded. It is, yes.
There's always room for complaints and challenges, I guess, in races like this where there's the possibility of contact. I know there was in one of the junior races this morning when somebody ended up being pushed in on a turn, but generally those things are few and far between. Men's under 23 C1 results there. Bala, Nagy, Vega, Gonzalez, Gluza, Bazzulli, Dlui and Prikhodko. Two Hungarians, two Spanish, and then the Polish separated by one of the Ukrainians. Otherwise that went in national order.
And it's still some guys left on the course.
.207 coming in there. Roman Furtak, Poland. And in the background behind us, we can hear the medal winners being called up for their presentations. They'll be putting their tracksuits on, getting into their national uniforms, and looking forward to getting the medal they've well deserved today out here. So pretty much rounding up a fantastic day of racing, Stefan.
Absolutely. Really great day with all the youngsters learning marathon and also providing us with excellent competition. It have been fair races and challenging races, and the conditions have been absolutely excellent. It's only a sign that the wind picks up now when the racing is over and clean out the air a little bit. And tomorrow we will be back with the senior racing, and that will be a lot more paddlers on the lake and a lot faster, and it's not about learning anymore, that's about pure racing for the medals. Hopefully we will have internet working a little bit better for us tomorrow. We have had great trouble with internet here today, which is of course one of the disadvantages to be located out in the wilderness, but it is many advantages as well, especially for us who are here. and enjoying this wonderful nature and wonderful Bushin Valley. But for all those of you that missed the initial part of this afternoon racing because the internet was down, it will be possible to experience on YouTube afterwards, because everything will be uploaded there to be able to watch, analyze and enjoy later on. Tomorrow we will start broadcasting at 9 o'clock, and it will be 3 sections also tomorrow, but before we comment too much on that, what is your experience, Ivan, of today's racing?
I think it's a very positive experience all around. The races, like you say, have been good, and it's been very visible to see the learning curve. The juniors made mistakes that the under 23s don't make, and the under 23s are making mistakes that you won't see tomorrow in the senior race. The racing's been good, the quality of the athletes is good. The venue can't be beaten. We keep telling everyone how great the venue is. We must be getting quite boring by now. But when you're sat here and you can see this place, you just think, yeah, if there's somewhere where you want to go kayaking, then you want to go here. It's just fantastic. And the atmosphere here is good. There's quite a lot of spectators, local spectators, plus a load of people holiday making around the lake itself. They're all watching. And it's just got a great vibe to the place. I think it's impossible to be here and not be cheerful today. Let's hope for more of the same tomorrow.
Absolutely. And tomorrow morning we will start off at 9 o'clock with the K2 Men Junior and K2 Women Junior. And 11:30 it's time for K1 Women Senior. And that will be a highlight, of course, watching the great queen of marathon racing, Renata Che, heading for 14th gold medal in the World Championships. I think she has.
No, I had a count up last night. So she's got 15 World Championship golds already.
Okay.
And she's got 8 European golds already. So she's going for her 9th European gold. She's leading the table in the medal table in Europeans with 8 golds, ahead of Attila Gyor from Hungary, who's got 7. Manuel Busto 6. Of course, he's retired now, so he's not going to be adding to that total. And then in world terms, Edwin Chabai from Hungary is leading with 17 golds, his C1 paddler. Actually, Attila Gyor is probably the most prolific medalist, even though he's down the table, because he only races in one class. Whereas Renata and Edwin Chabai both race in 2 classes. So maybe, you know, one of the most impressive athletes out there, is little known to most of us, is Attila Gyor.
Okay.
But Renata's here tomorrow and could this weekend add 2 more to her tally, which puts her further ahead of the rankings. You certainly can't argue with somebody who wins that many races.
Exactly. And 11:30 tomorrow is time, and hopefully we will have good internet then, and we can broadcast a very interesting race for K1 women. And then 14:45 tomorrow it's K1 men. Always a very, very good. Always providing very, very good races.